January 23, 2020. This article is a continuation of the Tracking the Leopard Mirage post published October 17, 2019, titled Playing Us False, The Ventriloquist of Cicada 3301. Under the subtitle Timelines. In their interpretation, I wrote, Cicada 3301 had three puzzles published sequentially on January 4, 2012, 2013, and 2014. Founder Bruce C. Clark, the former CIA manager, died on October 5, 2014, in Vienna, Austria. The second founder of this puzzle was Ian Murdoch, originator of the Debian project and Linux systems, who died under suspicious circumstances on December 28, 2015, although it was officially deemed to be a suicide. 19 days before Ian Murdoch's death, an agreement was written between Thomas Schoenberger, Michael Levine and Richard Lech to commercialize Cicada 3301. That agreement, dated December 9, 2015, represents day one of that enterprise, and therefore it is curious that on day 666, on October 4, 2017, the First Amendment to amended and restated attachment agreement was created. DeFanco had remarked that Thomas Schoenberger seemed to like the number 666, as it was part of his Shadowbox Strategies phone number. Circumstances surrounding the death of Ian Murdoch. On March 4, 2018, Terrence Renfro uploaded a video to his YouTube channel called Ian Murdoch Autopsy Report. Does this make sense to you? Under the case history section of the autopsy report, we read, the subject, a 42-year-old male, resides alone at 2410 Green Street, in San Francisco. The subject was found inside his locked residence, hanged by his neck, by San Francisco police officers performing a well-being check, after friends were concerned by the subject's suicidal ideations he was tweeting all day on social media. Friends of the subject read these tweets and became concerned for the subject's well-being. Reportedly, numerous anonymous persons began to call the San Francisco Police Department, asking for an officer to respond to the subject's residence for a well-being check. San Francisco Police responded to the subject's home at approximately 19:10 hours. Police officer Thompson number 1292 looked through the window of the subject's front door and saw the subject lying face down on the stairs, unresponsive. Then kicked the subject's locked front door down in order to gain access. Noticed the subject had an electric cord from a vacuum wrapped around his neck, unresponsive. According to the subject's neighbor, the subject was recently going through a lot of problems. The subject recently broke up with his girlfriend and was being evicted from his residence at the end of this month. The subject is a known drinker and can get out of control from time to time, per the neighbor. The police have been called to the subject's residence before by a neighbor due to loud noises, screaming, and reported domestic issues with his girlfriend, which have been caused by the subject's drinking. The autopsy report also indicated that there were traces of chlorodiazepoxide, noriazepam, diazepam, oxazepam and temazepam found in Ian Murdoch. The first four are used to help with anxiety or alcohol withdrawal, and the last one is for insomnia. The turmoil of Ian Murdoch's arrest 2 days prior. According to a report on a forum which quoted ArsTechnica.com on Ian Murdoch's death, 2 days prior to his death, at 11:30 p.m. on the 26th, police were called about someone attempting to break into a home. They found Murdoch yelling on the street outside a residence, and held him for questioning. He appeared to be drunk, and was hostile to the police resisting. The police called for paramedics who took him to the hospital. At 2:40 a.m. on Monday, the police were called again to the same address, with the caller stating that Murdoch had come back and was banging on the door and yelling. They arrested him for resisting arrest, assaulting emergency personnel, and two other misdemeanors. Later on Monday, police were called back to Murdoch's neighborhood on the 2400 block of Green Street in San Francisco and found Murdoch dead, apparently after committing suicide. The autopsy report includes a record of a phone call made to authorities by Ian Murdoch's sister on December 29, 2015, explaining that the subject has been having psychological issues for about 20 years, but she did not know if he ever made any suicide attempts before. A sample of Twitter messages around the December 28, 2015 death of Ian Murdoch. The autopsy report also reveals that Ian Murdoch left his own minor children out of his will. On May 6, 2016, Ian Murdoch's sister called the police regarding Ian Murdoch's property. The record of that phone call noted, there was a will that left everything to the girlfriend. The will is being contested by the family and a court date is scheduled for next week to review the will. So, after completing his computer science degree from Purdue, Ian Murdoch continued on to become a very wealthy man and was reputed to have earned $1.4 million in the year prior to his death. Yet his last will and testament apparently left nothing to his three minor children. I am assuming the court corrected this situation, since his children were young. What can never be rectified for these children is the knowledge that their father had written them out of his will, in the first place. Cicada 3301's mind-altering influence. The history of Cicada 3301 is not a noble one, despite the pretensions that the original founders were not motivated by money, but by higher ideals. How do online puzzle creations affect those who are drawn into their fictional world? These puzzles are not simply mathematical curiosities, but also the interweaving of religious and legendary motifs into the consciousness of the solver's mind. One should ponder what establishes the foundation for a sound mind, as compared to an unsound one, because the introduction of false philosophical systems by gurus or con artists often creates confusion and instability in a student who has a gentle soul. Consider Matthew 15:18, which says, "But those things which proceed out of the mouth come forth from the heart, and they defile the man." If that is true for the speaker, who is a teacher, is like the headwaters, then what effect does his defiling words have on his students, who drink of that stream? Just under 4 years after the first Cicada 3301 puzzle was published, and 19 days prior to Ian Murdoch's suicide, the December 9, 2015 contract between Thomas Schoenberger, Michael Levine and Michael Lutch was written with the intention of profiting off of the mystique of Cicada 3301. Of what significance is the death of Ian Murdoch? Death to our topic today, the cross of the Judas curse, where two forces meet. Let's just say for the time being, that similar to Judas, the manner of his death was classified as a suicide by hanging in the autopsy report. Stasis, where two forces meet. Stasis is a Greek word with a rich history, and in logic refers to a method of getting to the heart of an argument. It also has a meaning rooted in warfare, as stasis is where two forces meet. The symbol of the cross, the tree of execution of the Romans during the time of Jesus Christ, represents stasis. In the Old Testament in Deuteronomy 21:22-23, the man who has committed a sin worthy of death was hung on a tree as a sign of being accursed of God. The concept of stasis is ancient and deeply embedded in our being. On January 14, 2020, Jesse Davis published a video on his Just Me YouTube channel, in which he displays a screenshot of a July 7, 2017 email from Thomas A. Schoenberger of Sophia Musique to his wife Paula Davis. Schoenberger had represented himself to Tracking the Leopard Meraz as a Christian, yet here he explicitly denies the resurrection of Jesus Christ by declaring that Jesus never died on the cross. Approximately 7 months later, Thomas Schoenberger accused Paula Davis of becoming a Judas, in the sense that he regarded her as having betrayed him. Now the interesting thing is that by denying that Jesus died on the cross, Thomas Schoenberger was essentially acting both as an apologist for Judas Iscariot and as a revisionist historian of the Old and the New Testaments. In the style of his shadow box strategy's reputation defense business, Schoenberger's declaration is an attempt to exonerate Judas Iscariot's accountability for the death of Jesus Christ. Yet on the other hand, Schoenberger has a reputation for accusing others of being a Judas. Therein lies a subtle and confusing contradiction which serves as an example of why it is difficult for a reasonable person to follow this continuing saga, for what is constantly encountered is that occult mindset, known as the union of opposing principles. In less philosophical terms, we are dealing with liars. That self-contradictory style of confusion is again observable in a more recent incident which occurred on May 13, 2019, when Isaac Cappy reportedly killed himself after he dropped off of a highway overpass and was hit by an oncoming vehicle. Hours after that horrible event, several persons began suggesting that it was Thomas Schoenberger who was the influence behind Isaac Cappy's statement, "I am the reincarnation of Judas Iscariot, the great betrayer." That declaration is pivotal to the suicide scenario of Isaac Cappy. Schoenberger has responded to those allegations by claiming that he believed that Isaac Cappy had not committed suicide, but rather had been murdered, and he is promoting the idea that authorities might reopen the investigation into Cappy's death. The curse of Judas in the Old Testament. Usually when we think of the foreshadowing of Judas Iscariot in the Bible, the scriptures which come to mind involve the prophetic verses on Christ being valued at only 30 pieces of silver, and the familiar friend who became a betrayer. What never seems to be mentioned is this verse, Deuteronomy 27:25, "Cursed be he that taketh reward to slay an innocent person." And all the people shall say, "Amen." One of the aspects of Deuteronomy 27:25 is that the Hebrew gematria is 2455. Curiously, one finds in the Strong's Concordance of the King James Bible that the Greek word listed under 2455 is Judas. This Old Testament scripture says that a hired assassin is cursed if the target is an innocent person. Matthew 27:3-5 records the reaction of Judas Iscariot to the condemnation of Jesus, who he knew to be innocent. These verses say, "Then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself, and brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood. And they said, What is that to us? See thou to that. And he cast down the pieces of silver in the temple, and departed, and went and hanged himself. Thus Judas Iscariot comprehended that the curse of God was upon him for taking reward for delivering Jesus, an innocent man, over to those who condemned him to die upon the Roman cross. He coveted the reward of the assassin. The Isaac Cappy death. Puzzling connections. Recently, a distasteful GoFundMe was set up for $100,000 by Julio Cesario Chequez, as shown below. The purpose of this fundraiser is to make a documentary of Isaac Cappy, who committed suicide on May 13, 2019. Gabe Hoffman has filed a defamation lawsuit against Julio Cesario Chequez of All American Cartel LLC. One of the defamatory texts displayed by Jack has asserted that Gabe is now after Thomas Schoenberger because Gabe hired the hitman who killed Cappy. These accusations surrounding the death of Isaac Cappy are often speculative and self-serving, yet it is interesting to note how the Judas curse motif is woven into this story. I'm hoping that the three Gabe Hoffman defamation lawsuits will serve to lay out authenticated evidence on the legal table, because these free-flowing defamatory speculations made by many need to be silenced. Hoffman has also filed a defamation lawsuit against Thomas Schoenberger, which has not yet been served due to Schoenberger's ability to move about freely between unknown locations. Recently, Schoenberger has claimed that he is gathering evidence on his own, and in conjunction with an attorney, as a basis for a reinvestigation into Isaac Cappy's cause of death. I have been following this ongoing story since June 14, 2017. When the Port of Charleston dirty bomb hoax incident was reported by the mainstream news media. Subsequently, I began to publish the documents filed in the two civil defamation lawsuits which emerged from this situation, Robert David Steele and Earth Intelligence Network versus Jason Goodman, Patricia Negron and Queen Tut, Susan Lutsky/Holmes, and also the D. George Swigert versus Jason Goodman lawsuit. Until recently, I kept my focus narrow by purposely ignoring the messy underside of this legal tapestry, which involved the Seth Rich murder story and the peculiar world of the Cicada 3301 and Tungri 137 puzzles. The most noticeable thread seen on the front and the backside of this complex story is Manuel Chavez III, known as Defango, and more recently as the EO1 Yusuf Man. Unbeknownst to me in 2017-18 was Thomas Schoenberger, and his connections to multiple stories. Nathan Stoltman's 2017 observations. Nathan Stoltman on June 9, 2017, 5 days before the Port of Charleston incident, published a video called George Webb, Defango, Cicada 3301, Tungri 137 and the 7 Degrees of PSYOP on his Lift the Veil YouTube channel. At the 6.06 mark, Nathan Stoltman says, "And Defango is working with somebody who is an agent and he's working intimately with him, so that's a problem, but he doesn't know any better, you know, but this is the PSYOP. Sorry, I say things I sometimes shouldn't say. I'm excited, but that's the fact, it's a guy that's contacted other truthers before with this info and disinfo guests, for example Steve Pachenik, Robert Steele, these people are pit I've been pitched, you know Steele before. It's disinfo. They're trying to get my stink of legitimacy on them for my audience, who they care about for some reason. Same way they care about Defango's audience and why they're gonna play along. They want to be his friend. Everybody wants to be Defango's friend right now. Everybody must feel good. People want to be my friend too until I tell them to F off. But you gotta be careful who you associate with." 7.20. Nathan Stoltman continues, 7.54, "The puzzles you're working on, Cicada, you know those are designed to find the smartest people, the ones that want the truth. The ones that want to change the world. Tag them, map them, and control them. And I'm afraid that's you know what's going on. It, in the case of you know a genuine person, you know Defango, well, actually he's involved with it because of the damn puzzles. This puzzle thing in the George Webb story, it's a puzzle. It's designed to take smart people who could be solving problems in this world and get them going down rabbit holes. Not only that, identify them, map them, and control them. George Webb. Cicada 3301, Tungri 137, bulletin boards you know, 4chan, they're all designed to find you, tag you, map you, and control you. That's the freaky PSYOP." At the 10.45 mark, Stolpman remarks, This guy that DeFango works with, all he's ever done to me is misdirect me and invite me to his house. By the way, puzzles, Hollywood, and I know because that same guy is reaching out to other YouTubers pitching the same bullshit. So other YouTubers, wake up, it's not the world you think it is. The people in your comments are not the people you think they are, especially if they really like you and they really agree with what you're talking about. That's when you really worry, because they'll misdirect you. It's a big effing psyop. Dopey Dave also utilizes the same motif of suicide and death executions. Schoenberger feels that the blame for these Dopey Dave videos lies primarily with Marcus Conti, Manuel Chavez III, and Kerry Wolf, aka All Seeing You. However, because this YouTube account is anonymous, I have approached this situation from a different angle as seen in my article dated December 21, 2019, Dopey Dave's Wheel of Misfortune. In the most recent Dopey Dave video, published on January 19, 2020, titled Dopey Dave the Actor is a Homo God, one of the targets included the son of Thomas Schoenberger. Despite my many differences with Thomas Schoenberger, I felt compelled to email him to express my extreme displeasure with the originators of the Dopey Dave videos and to say that I am praying against such persons that have targeted his innocent son. Whatever your opinion is of Thomas Schoenberger, his son has nothing to do with this ongoing internet war of words. On his Grabbler Babe YouTube account, Thomas Schoenberger on January 19, 2020 stated that it was his final video for a year, and he identified 5 persons who would be observed to be judged within the coming year. Of course it was not really his final video for the year, but I would like to note that 2 of the persons on that list, Manuel Chavez III and the graphic artist known as Lestat, were actively involved in business associations with Schoenberger, including Cicada 3301. A third person, Esteban Trujillo, is included because he has been actively documenting Cicada 3301 history through various interviews. Apparently the dark sphere of internet puzzles does not desire light to be shed on their inner workings. Why would anyone think they were the reincarnation of Judas Iscariot? Maybe someone who believes that Jesus never died on the cross, but there is an American Messiah in our midst? Isaac Cappy said something that was interesting in an Instagram post displayed a couple of days prior to his death. His unsigned confessional statement declared, "Also, it should be noted that I have recently been made to believe that I am the reincarnation of Judas Iscariot, the great betrayer." The date of this confessional was July 4, 2019, which was 52 days after his death. Who is it that Isaac Cappy claimed was causing him to regard himself as the great betrayer, Judas Iscariot? Why did Cappy feel that he had to carry the cross of the curse of Judas? And why are there those who are attempting to capitalize on his death? Esteban Trujillo de Gutierrez on January 25, 2020 at 7:17 a.m. said, "Thank you for your insights, Ms. Weaver." Mr. Schoenberger's criticisms of me recently shifted from calling me a CIA agent, which is ignorant terminology, and cocaine trafficker and pedophile, to claiming that one of my ex-wives asserted that I am prone to PTSD rages. Oh, and I am now at DHS whatever. Apparently because somebody with legal expertise advised him that he was committing felony violations of Title 50 by blowing my imaginary cover as a CIA officer. While Schoenberger cyberbullies me and 28 other victims, and you are one of them, he evades legal service from judicial documents filed by Gabe Hoffman, Jesse Davis and Manuel Chavez III. Will his probation be revoked? He can run, but he will just end up tired. His violations of Title 50 and Title 18 cyberstalking are documented. He committed them, and the internet never forgets. Nor do I. His cowardly ad hominem attacks on me are underscored by his blocking me on Twitter. He got tired of me getting his accounts suspended, failing to understand that I merely reported his own words. I asked it elsewhere, what does Thomas Schoenberger see when he gazes in a mirror? We should not even attempt to understand. As Nietzsche noted, those who fight monsters are prone to become monsters themselves. I am simply writing about Cicada 3301. That is what an historian does. I would prefer to address his own undistinguished role with that organization and then move on, but he claims that chronicling his incompetence and complicity in the implosion of that cypherpunk order is gangstalking. At some point, a judge will make a determination. In the meantime, I am continuing to write. I admit that I enjoy his rants about RICO and conspiracy, and I look forward to referring the FBI agents that he claims are investigating me to my lawyer. My lone regret is that his own conspiratorial circle may end up excluding an incompetent researcher who will surely post here shortly. Unfortunately, his public collusion with Schoenberger may leave him an unindicted co-conspirator. But I am an optimist. We are not dealing, after all, with smart people. They are prey to their own rages and they demonstrably find it difficult to control themselves. And none of us can undo the past. With my best regards, Esteban.